Corinthians chapter 3. We're going through the Bible. We find ourselves in the second epistle written to the church in the city of Corinth. And the title of our message, let me get there. I'm not even organized up here. The Glory of the New Covenant is the title of the message. And man, there's a lot of things that are just circulating in my head right now. Just where we're at as a nation, divided as we are. How the church is losing young adults by the droves. And they're no longer just feeling that the church is able to relate. And yet you have this commandment in the Bible that says that we should go to church, but is the church meeting the needs of the culture? And so these are things that I prayerfully consider. These are things that I struggle with. I do believe that God has all the answers for all of the problems, but are we hearing God, and are we able to be connected with God to be able to hear what those solutions are and how to communicate them to the world? So just this is everything that's going on in my little head right now, just as I come up here and think about this. But the glory of the new covenant is something to behold. And so let's take a look at this, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, we just thank you for the time of worship, an opportunity, Lord, just to turn our hearts towards you and to be able to sing to you and call upon you, Lord, cry out to you. And I pray that those words, Lord, would be just prayers ascending to you, prayers of adoration and praise and worship. You are worthy of our worship. And so we thank you, Lord, for those opportunities. And now as we have, Lord, just this time to be able to spend time in your word, we pray, Father, that you would open up our ears, open up our eyes, and let us see and hear what you want to say to the church this morning. So take this time as we offer it up to you and be with us in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. So Paul is going through this epistle, and there's this misunderstanding with this church in the city of Corinth, and they're not really seeing Paul's heart. And so last week in chapter 2, he exposed it, and he was extremely candid with them. He let them know that he even missed opportunities of serving God, something that Paul, the Apostle Paul, would never do, and yet he's just being very vulnerable. And so we get to this next chapter, and on the heels of what we learned last week, let's go ahead and look at verses 1 through 3. He says, do we begin again to commend ourselves? Or do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you or letters of commendations from you? You are our epistles written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Clearly you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is, of the heart. And so he opens up the chapter and he starts by saying, do I need a letter of commendation from you? Or do I need to bring you a letter of commendation to you? And then he lets them know, you're my letter. You're my epistle. And so the application for us in that is, and you've probably heard it said, we are the only Bibles that some people will ever read. Some people may never open up the pages of the Word of God. They'll never open up the Bible. But they're looking at our lives. And what are we projecting to them? What are we communicating to the world as they read this epistle, as they look into our lives? And usually that's a great point to be able to just get us into this guilt. Oh, yeah, I'm falling short again, man. I messed it up again this week. Yeah, man, if they read me this week, not a good week. You know, and that's usually where we go with that. But the reality is, do you have a relationship with the Lord? And is that hopefully what they're reading? In the midst of our imperfection, in the midst of our struggle, in the midst of our questions, in the midst of our doubts, in the midst of, yes, maybe it's not perfect right now. But you know what? I serve a God that's perfect. I serve a God that I can go to in the midst of my pain, in the midst of my confusion, in the midst of my doubts. That's my God. Hopefully that's what you're reading in my life. That, you know, though maybe this life right here isn't perfect and all figured out, whoo, I look to a God that is perfect and has it all figured out. He's not pacing in heaven. He's not wringing his hands or shaking his head and wondering, scratching his head, wondering what we're going to do next. He's got it all under control. He's got it all figured out. And that's the God that I pray to. And that's the God that hopefully I'm pointing you to. And so it's not necessarily about me and my perfection that doesn't exist. But it's the God that I love and serve. And he came after me. He wooed me, drew me. And man, now I have a relationship with him. And I'm hoping that's what they're reading. I'm hoping that's what the world is able to see. The reality that I have a relationship with the creator of the universe. And even though I struggle, and even though my life is not maybe perfect at this moment, my God is. Because I think we fake it. That thing in the world, right? Fake it till you make it. Yeah, that's dumb. Because we see through the fake it until you make it, don't we? I mean, honestly, don't you see through the fake it till you make it? When people like don't know what they're doing, but I'm pretending I know what I'm doing as I do this thing that I'm faking until I make it. Yeah, no, we see right through the fake it until you make it. The reality is God's got it figured out. And so Paul is known that he's poured into this church in the city of Corinth. He's spent a year and a half with them. And he discipled them, and he taught them, and he lived amongst them. And so they saw the reality of his life, and they saw the things that maybe he struggled with. But in the midst of that, he knows that they are his letter of commendation. They are his living epistle. They are the ones that he can point to. And then he makes sure to let us know that clearly you are an epistle of Christ. It's Jesus that's doing a supernatural work in your lives. And God used me to some degree to be able to pour into you, to love on you, to teach you the truth of the scriptures. But Jesus is the one we point to. And you are my letter of commendation. You are my letter of reference. If anybody knows, hey, what's your ministry? Hey, you have a doctorate in divinity? No, I don't have a doctorate in divinity. I know people can go to school and get a doctorate in divinity. And that's real high up with the, you know, spiritual education, if you will. But you know what I've done? I've just walked through the open doors that the Lord has set for me. That's all I've done for the last 30 years in my life as a Christian. God would open a door and I'd be like, Lord, you gonna let me teach the little ones? Like my daughters are real little, and so I get to go in there and just play with them and blow bubbles. That was the big thing at children's ministry, bubble machine. You just get the bubble machine going, it's over, it's done, right? And then after that, as they would grow up, I would just follow them in the little classrooms that they were in. Lord, you gonna let me teach fifth graders? Man, that's crazy. Lord, I get to teach junior high schoolers. I am a junior high schooler. Woo! You know? And just get crazy with the... And just as they came up, the Lord would open doors of opportunity for me and my wife, and we would serve the Lord. But you didn't go to college, and you didn't go to get a degree? No. I just served Jesus. And I would lead people to the Lord, pray with them to receive the Lord, and just minister, study the Bible, and the Holy Spirit would guide. Yeah, you don't have any credentials. I beg to differ. I beg to differ. As I look into the lives that God has allowed me to touch just a little. And that's for all of us. You are our living epistles. You are letters of commendation. So Paul is pointing to Exhibit A, church in Corinth. Look at your lives. Look at your transformed lives. Look at your changed lives. You're walking in one direction away from God. Now you're walking in a whole nother direction towards God. He goes on in verse 4. And we have such trust through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. And so Paul introduces this idea of the old covenant and the new covenant. And we are ministers of the new covenant. And you have to contrast the old covenant with the new covenant. The Greek word for covenant is diatheke. It had the ordinary meaning of last will and testament. Paul's use of the word reinforces the sovereignty of God because it is not a negotiated settlement, but a divine decree. And so you have this new covenant. The word covenant describes an arrangement made by one party with plenary power, which the other party may accept or reject, but cannot alter. A covenant offered by God to man was no compact between two parties coming together on equal terms. And so God set up the new covenant. And he's the one that established the guidelines. And what Paul is going to do here, he's going to contrast the old covenant with the new covenant to show way better. Woo, way better. I mean, if the old covenant was good, man, there's no like comparison with the new covenant. And so we're going to see that a little bit as we go through it. Romans 7, chapter 7, verses 5 and 6 puts it like this. Romans chapter 7, verses 5 and 6. For when we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to death. But now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by, so that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. And so this old covenant and new covenant, what's the contrast? Well, what did the old covenant do? It showed you that you were guilty. It showed you that you were imperfect. Mr. Law is held up as Mr. Perfect. And no matter how hard we try, yeah, we fall short of Mr. Perfect. We fall short of the law. We fall short of being perfect. And so it condemned us. It showed us we were guilty. And every year, animals would be sacrificed for the sins of people who fell short. And every year, those sins would be covered temporarily in the old covenant. How do Jews do it today? They don't. There's no temple. There's no temple where sacrifices can be made. And so where are they? Living literally in their sins. They thought that they can replace the fact that there is no temple and no sacrifices could be made. They thought that they could replace it by good works. But you can't do enough good works. And by the works of the law, no flesh will be received, I think the Bible says in the book of Galatians. And so unfortunately, they find themselves in their sins. God comes along with the new covenant, the new testament, the new promise. And he comes up with this way, way better idea. I like that last part. He says, not of the letter, but of the spirit. For the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. He's not saying that the law is bad. We agree with the law. The law is good. It's good not to lie. It's good to tell the truth, right? That's a good thing. It's good not to do all of those things that the law says you shall not do. And it's good to do those things that the law says we should be doing. So we're not saying that the law is bad. We're saying that the law killed us because it showed us that we were imperfect. But the Spirit, he says, gives life in contrast to the old covenant. The glory of the old covenant is seen in Exodus chapter 19. And if you were to read verses 16 all the way through chapter 20, verse 1, you would see that God had placed his presence on a mountain, Mount Sinai, right? And thunders and earthquakes and trembling and just all of this stuff taking place with the presence of God, to the point where the nation of Israel, the children of Israel, they couldn't even look at the mountain. And there was this trepidation and this fear because God was so holy and they knew that they weren't. And God was holy other than anything else that they had ever experienced. And that's true in the old covenant. In the new covenant, it remains true, but God gives us incredible access. Let's continue to read on verse 7. But if the ministry of death written and engraved on stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? Verse 9. For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. And so he begins to now just show us this contrast between the old and the new. The old covenant was a ministry of condemnation, but the new covenant is the ministry of righteousness. The old covenant is passing away, but the new covenant remains. The old covenant was restrictive and separated a man from God. The new covenant brings us to God and enables us to come boldly to Him. The essential need of prayer and evangelism. It has been rightly said that it is more important to talk to God about men than it is to talk to men about God. But we can do both. So not only do we want to share the gospel with people, talk to men about God, but we'd better have spent time with God talking to God about people who we're going to be sharing with. Why? Because something supernatural is taking place. You have the greatest arguments in the world. You can know all the answers. You can talk to somebody until they're blue in the face or you're blue in the face. And if the Spirit of the living God does not take the words that you're saying and bring them to their ears, their spiritual ears, they'll fall on deaf ears. Have you noticed that? And so not only do we want to talk to individuals about God, but we got to make sure that we talk to God about individuals, about people that we're sharing with, about people that we're coming in contact with. He goes on in verse 10. For even what was made glorious had no glory in this respect because of the glory that excels. For if what was passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious. He mentioned Moses, and he's going to continue on that theme. Verse 12. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. Interesting note. If you were to read Exodus 33, as we did in our time of responsive reading, you have this story, right? This account where Moses says, God, you've said that I found grace in your sight. But Lord, I want more. I want to see you. Lord, I want to see your glory. And God says, well, nobody can see my face and live. I'm consuming. It's too much for anybody. And so this is what I'll do, Moses. I'll put you in a rock. Not on a rock, but in a cleft of a rock. And I'll cover you with my hand. I'm going to pass by. And you're going to see my afterglow. You're going to see my glory, but it's not my full glory. It's just what I leave behind once I walk by you. And so once I walk past you, I'm going to remove my hand and you'll see my glory. And as you continue to read, you get the idea that when Moses comes down the hill after spending time with God, his face was lit up. So it's like a candle. I don't know, like a, what are those things that you break at a rave? I don't know. I don't do raves. Just saying. Toot, toot. With a glow stick. So it's like a glow stick, right? His face is like a glow stick. And sorry for the illustration. And you would think as you read through Exodus 33, 34, you start reading through it, you're thinking that because the nation of Israel was scared or fearful to look at Moses, it reminded them of how awesome God was. And there's this trepidation that Moses covered it on their behalf. But the Bible here is telling us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, it was fading away. And that's why Moses veiled his face. He didn't want the nation of Israel to see that the glory was disappearing. And again, there's a contrast there between the old and the new covenant. Interesting little insight. He goes on, verse 14, but their minds were blinded, for until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament because the veil is taken away in Christ. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and when the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So what many of our churches have done through this verse is they've taken it out of its context, of course, and our Pentecostal charismatic churches, which we are Pentecostal and charismatic, in case you didn't know, We believe in all the gifts of the Spirit. But what they've done is they've taken them out of context and says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. So we could do anything we want because the Spirit of the Lord is moving. That's out of context. He's talking about the old covenant and the new covenant. And he's saying we've been set free from the law. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's the liberty, the freedom to know that I'm going to heaven, not because of anything I can do, anything that I've done, but because of what God has done. And so we don't do that. We don't take scriptures out of context to make them a pretext and then get off on doing something that we feel that we want to do. We stay biblical. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, did it not say, let all things be done, speaking of the gifts, decent and in order? And so it's both of those. It's all things. Yes, speak in tongues. Yes, interpret tongues. Yes, words of wisdom. Yes, words of knowledge. Yes, prophecy. All of the gifts, decent and in order. No more than two, three at the most, in a believer's meeting, with interpretation. If there's no interpretation, sit down. All tongues is me communicating with God, the wonderful works of God, clearly delineated within the scriptures. As we study the scriptures, we begin to understand what these gifts are and what they mean. And I think it can be done according to the scriptures. So we got to be careful with that. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Paul's thinking follows like this. When Moses went into God's presence, he had the liberty to take off the veil. The presence of the Lord gave him this liberty. We have the Holy Spirit, who is the Lord. We live in the Spirit's presence because he is given to us under the new covenant. So just as Moses had the liberty to relate to God without the veil in the presence of the Lord, so we have the liberty because of the presence of the Holy Spirit to be able to relate to God. John Calvin says this. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Poole says this. A liberty from the yoke of the law, from sin, death, hell, but the liberty which seemeth here to be chiefly intended is a liberty from that blindness and hardness which is upon men's hearts until they have received the Holy Spirit. So we have that freedom in Christ. Our last verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 says, but we all, with unveiled faces, no veil, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. God is transforming us from glory to glory, not from glory to backsliding, not from glory to failure, from glory to glory. We, with unveiled, no cover, no dimly look. When he says that we look in a mirror, beholding as in a mirror, mirrors were different back in the days. We could see the glory of the Lord, but we cannot see his glory perfectly. A mirror in the ancient world did not give nearly as good a reflection as our mirrors do today. Ancient mirrors were made of polished metal and gave a clouded, fuzzy, somewhat distorted image. Paul is saying we can see the glory of the Lord, but we can't see it perfectly yet. And so as the Lord is growing us up and teaching us, as I look at our culture and just the things that were racing through my mind when I came up here and I was just mentioning how are we going to reach a culture of millennials, 20 to 35 year olds that have left the church in droves, the biggest percentage and the biggest numbers of individuals that have left the church. It's going to take the Spirit of the living God, and it's going to take us to not want to do church as church. This is the way we've always done it. I think it's going to take us looking to the Lord. It says beholding. The word means more than a casual look. It means a careful study. We all have something to behold, something to study. We can be transformed by the glory of the Lord, but only as we carefully study it. It's not going to become with your best ideas and my best ideas. It's going to become from the Lord. Let me read you this article I found. Not everyone sees the truth when they look in the mirror. 30-year-old David gets up every morning, and his morning routine only gets as far as the bedroom mirror, where he sees a horrible, distorted face, a crooked, swollen nose covered with scars and a bulging eye. The pain from his deformities caused him to quit college and move in with his parents 10 years ago. Since then, he has rarely left his room, afraid to let anyone see him. He has had cosmetic surgery 4 times with no progress. That's because the problem with David's appearance are only in his mind. Experts call it body dysmorphic disorder, or BDD, body dysmorphic disorder. It causes people to imagine themselves as deformed, ugly people. Psychiatrists call it a hidden epidemic. One psychiatrist says patients are virtually coming out of the woodwork. I'm meeting with one new patient each week. Most BDD sufferers are convinced that the problem is with their face. Those afflicted I live with such an overwhelming sense of shame that they can barely function. One young teacher in Boston tried to continue her job, but would run out in the middle of class, afraid that her imagined hideous appearance was showing through her thick makeup. A Denver businessman called his mother from the office 15 times a day for reassurance that he did not look grotesque, and spent hours in the bathroom stall with a pocket mirror, trying to figure out a way to improve his appearance. Some try to cope with harmful rituals and cut themselves to bleed the damaged area. BDD sufferers are usually convinced that the problem is with their body and not their mind. They don't want to see anybody but a plastic surgeon and dermatologist for their problem. And so as I read this, I thought, that's what's wrong with this culture, and that's what's going on. People have been lied to and told from this perspective, from religious leaders or people that should know better, that God's mad at you, that God's upset with you, that your lifestyle is disapproving to God. And no matter what you try to do, it's not going to be good. Why? Because they're living by the law. Well, I got to be good enough. I got to be perfect. I got to get it figured out. I got to clean this up. I've got to fix it. Is that what the mirror says? Is that what the Bible says? Is that what the Bible teaches? And so people in this culture have been read and given really a bill of goods. I told you that there was a quote from Calvin. Calvin speaks to this great design of God. He says that the image of God, which has been defaced by sin, may be repaired within us. The progress of this restoration is a continuous through the whole of life, because it is little by little that God causes his glory to shine forth in us. How is this to take place? It says it right there in the scriptures. The last words he says in that verse, by the Spirit of the Lord. With these last words, Paul is emphasizing 2 things. First, this access to God and his transforming process is ours by the new covenant. Because it is through the new covenant we are given the Spirit of the Lord. Secondly, this work of transformation really is God's work in us. It happens by the Spirit of the Lord, not by the will or effort of man. We don't achieve or earn spiritual transformation by beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. We simply put ourselves in a place where we can be transformed by the Spirit of the Lord. And if they're not coming to church to hear the message that God loves them, that God wants to grow them, that God has a plan for them that's better, and he's not mad at them, how are they going to get this? Isn't it crazy? Because on one hand, they don't want to come. On the other hand, they need it so desperately. But how many churches are teaching the message of the scriptures? Turn with me to James chapter 1. We'll close here. James chapter 1 in your New Testament, all the way in the back after the book of Hebrews. And we'll have it up here for you, if we can get it. James chapter 1, starting at verse 21. The Bible says, therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. Isn't that an awesome culmination of the new covenant? That God's commandments are not meant to bum us out, to rip us off, to rob us of something, that some pleasure, some experience in life that is going to be more meaningful than being molded and shaped into the image of Jesus. And he calls it the perfect law of liberty, the thing that sets us free from self, from sin, from death, from the world, the flesh, and the devil, our enemies. Jesus said, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And whom the Son sets free is free indeed." And so the lies that Satan has put out in the world, and the lies that are being just sold all over, a bunch of lies made to rip us off. And so as we sit under the Word, there's this transformation that begins to take place. The renewing of our minds is what Romans 12 calls it. And instead of being brainwashed, our brains are actually being washed, cleansed, cleaned from the brainwashing of the world and its lies and its systems out there. And so Satan's good at what he does, but God has a way. And so we need to compel them to come in. We need to continue to pray for people that we come in contact with, that they would come to know, taste, and see that the Lord is good. And as you sit under the Word, you just have this transformation that's taking place, and God is renewing our minds. He's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of a sound mind. And all of the lies of the enemies are able to just come in with God's Word, and just God cleanses us little by little. So cooperate with God. Participate with God in the new covenant. You don't have to worry about what everyone else thinks. Just hone in that voice of God. And if you ever want to spend time with God and you want to see His glory, it's something you do alone. Ask Him, "Lord, show me Your glory." And if you notice when we read Exodus chapter 33, His glory is synonym for His presence and His goodness. "Lord, I want to see Your glory. Then let me show You my goodness." And you should be experiencing it as you're walking and talking with your Savior, right? And so we just come to church to kind of just, "Ooh, all right, I need to hear that." And then we go out and do it. This ain't where it's at. Do it out there. So I want to encourage you guys with that. I'll close with this. As I was just studying this week and I was looking at this, I was reminded again of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You have three opportunities of a relationship with the Holy Spirit. There's one God revealed in three persons. One God, three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. All equally God, individual, distinct from one another. God is not the Holy Spirit, or the Father is not the Holy Spirit. Jesus is not the Father. They're distinct. There's a lot of religions out there that are teaching just false doctrine. I'll call it that. One God revealed in three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Our relationship, our connection back to the Father has made possible through the Son. Jesus Christ gives us access to the Father by the power of the Holy Spirit. So you have three opportunities to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. We don't talk a lot about the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit's job is to point to Jesus. That's His job. That's what He does. That's His ministry. And so if you go to a church where it's Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, that's not from God. Why? Because the Holy Spirit's job is to point people to Jesus. It's in the Scriptures, John chapter 16. Does that mean that the Holy Spirit doesn't have something for you and me as Christians to be able to get to know? No, no. So you have three opportunities of a relationship with the Holy Spirit. And there are three prepositions: with, in, and upon. The with experience is the whole world experiences this relationship. The Holy Spirit is with you, convicting you, pointing you to the cross, showing you a need for God in your life. When you submit or surrender to that, then you have a relationship with God. The Holy Spirit dwells within you. Jesus comes into your heart. You become a Christian. If you resist that while the Holy Spirit is with you, if you resist that one sin right there, that will be the only sin that will send you to hell. Only one sin will damn you in eternity. Resisting the Holy Spirit as He's with you, showing you, dude, look at your life. Gal, I don't know what we call girls. Gal, look at your life. You need God. You need to bring God into your life. Look at what Jesus has done for you. If you resist that over your life, that is called the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Okay? Your second opportunity in a relationship with the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit in you. So the Holy Spirit is now in you as a Christian. So as you're walking and talking throughout the day, the Holy Spirit is in you. And what is He doing? Convicting you of sin. If you resist that, you are, what is the word? Grieving the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit's in you now. I'm a Christian. I received Jesus into my life, into my heart. Holy Spirit is in me, convicting me, showing me. Stop talking. Don't say that to her. Don't say it like that. Lower your voice. You're yelling. You don't think you're yelling, but you're yelling. Holy Spirit's faithful to do that, right? This is my life. I'm just giving you a moment in my life, okay? Me and my wife. I'm just giving you a moment, right? Don't talk to her like that. That's my daughter. Before she was your wife, she was my daughter. Don't talk to her like, right? And I'm like, so I can resist that, can I? La, 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 la. Lord, I'm making the point. I'm going to win the argument. Lord, I don't win a lot of arguments. Lord, let me win this one. Lord, no. And I can resist the Holy Spirit in me. Or I can yield. I can say, Lord, you're right. That's your daughter. It's my sister before she was my wife. All right, Lord, I gave you. All right, I'm sorry. Right? And you give in. You repent. You ask for forgiveness, right? Holy Spirit in you, convicting you. The third opportunity that you have for a relationship with the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit upon you. It's found in John chapter 20, where Jesus would say, I want you guys to go to Jerusalem and I want you to wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And then you go to the book of Acts and you read Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. And verse 8 specifically says, and the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will receive power to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And so the Holy Spirit comes upon you to baptize you. No, I don't want none of that stuff. I got enough. I'm going to heaven, right? Yeah, you're going to heaven. My name's in the book of life. Yeah, your name's in the book of life. I've seen it. They fly off of chandeliers and they start talking in tongues and I don't want none of that. When you resist the Holy Spirit upon you, you're quenching the Holy Spirit. Guys, what God calls us to do in the scriptures is not hard and it's not difficult. It's impossible. And the only way that we can do what God has called us to do is through His power. He does it inside the new covenant. He does it in us so that He could do it through us. So don't neglect that. And get back refilled, filled over and over again. Get back to that first love that Revelation chapter 2 talks about. Just the simplicity of you and Jesus, your relationship with the Lord. But don't quench, don't grieve, and definitely don't blaspheme. Cultivate that relationship with God, Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, and the way we receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit is simply by asking, just like we received you, Jesus, into our lives, into our hearts. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you that in this new covenant, you want to give us all of you. And you declare, Lord, that you being evil, knowing how to give good gifts to your children, how much more does the Father in heaven want to give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? And so, Father, for any of my brothers and sisters that need the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I pray that they would simply ask. And upon asking, Lord, give you thanks and receive by faith, Lord, that you want to give them what they need. Thank you for the new covenant, Lord. Thank you that we can have life with you. And Father, help us to reach this culture for your glory, for your kingdom, for your name's sake. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.